Conservation medicine next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman. The subject, conservation medicine. Our guest, Dr. Alonso Aguirre. He is a member of the faculty of Columbia University, Tufts University. He's senior vice president, the conservation medicine program of the Wildlife Trust, which is based in New York City. And well, he was among the scientists about 10, 15 years ago who coined the term conservation medicine. Alonso, what is that about, conservation medicine?
Good afternoon, Carl. It's a pleasure to be here. Conservation medicine came as a need to bring scientists together to address the environmental problems we have today. If we define it extremely briefly, it can be considered the practice of ecological health. And ecological health can be defined as the interactions and linkages between human health, animal health and plant health, and ecosystem health. So it's really trying to look at not only at the impacts of humans that are having the planet, including habitat fragmentation, deforestation, and of course the human ecological footprint. That is we humans are inducing a lot of extinctions. We are fragmenting habitats and we are destroying ecosystems. Not only that, now, because we have the field of conservation biology that started back in the 80s, and really we kind of spin off from there in looking not only at extinctions, at habitats, but also three major issues arise. One of them is emerging diseases rising since 1980s, affecting wildlife, humans and animals, and domestic animals. And not only that, we see recently cases like West Nile virus affecting New York in the late 90s, spreading like wildfire through America. We have H5N1, highly pathogenic influenza, and the latest one was H1N1, what we call swine flu, wrongly named. Also, the other two issues that conservation medicine deals with is what we call global toxification. There's a lot of pollutants being released in biosphere every year. In fact, over 100,000 contaminants have been released in the biosphere, and we have technologies only to measure 6% of them in the laboratory. So lastly, the issue that arises and we're facing is climate change. And climate change, or global environmental change, I would like to say. At the microcosmos, we start seeing that's causing shifting of species. It's causing also effects on diseases and new species taking over new habitats. So conservation medicine, in a small way, is bringing scientists to work in a transdisciplinary way to address these environmental problems.
What a mess we've made of the world. Let's talk perhaps on the positive side right off before we get into all these negatives. I mean, what you're talking about is pollution in all its forms impacting on animal life, and your specialty is marine life, on plant life, and you know, up the chain, human life. I mean, it's what a downer, and it seems to be getting worse and worse. What's the positive? I'm not speaking about the positive side of pollution, but like, can we just jump to, can this trend, can this direction be changed?
I think I'm a very positive person in many ways, regardless of the problems the environment are facing. I think humans eventually, even though we like to trash, we still trash the planet in many ways. We are very conscious and conscious of what we're doing to improve the environment. So it's a big movement after President Bush confirmed that actually we're dealing with change in the climate in a global way. I think the American people are changing their behavior. They're becoming more community-oriented, trying to consume the local goods, and Long Island is a perfect example of that. We're pushing to go back to raise our own chickens. I have chickens at home, collect my eggs, and we distribute them out to neighbors, and then we'll get goods from them like tomatoes. And so one way to that I think is positive, people are realizing that globalization has a huge impact on economies. But also going back to our local roots is a very positive way to go about it. And also become green in many ways. Now people are more conscious about their cars. They like to drive hybrids. They like to take local transportation. So in fact, for example, a flight from New York City to Los Angeles will consume the gasoline of the lifetime of 100 Hummers.
Mm.
And so you see, we are, I think, trying to be aware and we're conscious of our next generation, really, that we are enough people to consume the resources of 2 to 6 planets now. I mean, 8 billion or 7 billion people right now and provide all the goods that we have in a basic American family, we will need to provide out of 6 planets that we don't have. So we have to find other ways for sustainability. And I think people are more aware of that.
Speaking of roots, let's just go get into your background. You were born, you were raised in Baja California?
Yes, correct. I was raised in a small village in the west coast of Baja California called Bahia Asuncion, a small fishing town now being slowly developed as everything else. But my grandparents were part of the fishing cooperative, one of the few sustainable fisheries in the world dealing with lobster and abalone. As I was growing up, I remember my grandfather will bring sea turtles out of the ocean, sharks, and some interesting species. And that's when I became extremely aware of the environment and what we can do to look at these species in a different way.
The first time I heard Professor Aguirre speak, it was about sea turtles. This is a number of years ago at a conference, and you gave a presentation. How was that? I mean, you were very, very worried, alarmed in that presentation on the future of sea turtles. How was your background in Baja California with your grandfather fishing for sea turtles connected to what became a big part of your life's work?
Carl, it's a very interesting question because really sea turtles open a whole world professionally and individually for me. Basically, my grandfather will give us to drink raw sea turtle blood.
Oh.
And he will say that this blood, well, you could add a little lime in it. But other than that, you had to drink a glass of blood because he said that was very good for asthma and anemia. And then after that, I saw something was wrong of sea turtles. And to date, after all those years, 40 years, I realized that sea turtles are in extreme decline. All 7 species are in danger of extinction. And interestingly, I work with loggerheads along the California coast. And by 1980, I began to be getting involved in conservation of sea turtles. And by 1991, accidentally, while I was working at Oregon State, started to work with green turtles in the Hawaiian Islands that suffer from a tumor disease called fibropapillomatosis. From then on, I've been involved in several projects globally in looking at the health of these turtles as use them as sentinels of our environment. Can they tell us something going wrong in the oceans?
Can sea turtles be sentinels?
Oh, absolutely, Carl. What we found in recent years is that sea turtles utilized very important habitats that humans love. Very nice coral reefs, nice beaches to nest. And now we're seeing that some populations are being affected by this fatal, many times fatal and disfiguring disease. So we're seeing that sea turtles can tell us that something's going wrong with the oceans, related to pollution, to disease, to agricultural runoff. In fact, the disease has been related to warm waters, to highly dense populations, and agricultural runoff, at least for the Hawaiian Islands. We have observed that these turtles will start with tumors when they recruit to nearshore environments. So we know they're picking up the infection. I will call it infection because we think it's a virus or several viruses involved in causing these tumors. They will, as soon as they recruit from the pelagic environment, they come to these benthic habitats, and as probably they are about 30 centimeters long. When they're about 40 centimeters, we start seeing the tumors. So it affects juvenile turtles when they right come and feed near shore.
Sort of the marine canaries of the environment, turtles. And the Hawaiian Islands are in the middle of the Pacific. There's just thousands of miles of ocean on both sides. You're saying that runoff on the Hawaiian Islands will affect turtles?
Yes, it's very interesting, and you're right. We have these beautiful islands smack in the middle of the Pacific, and yet there is a huge industry, sugarcane, pineapple, and we use a lot of fertilizers and a lot of nitrogen to keep those pineapples going. Like Dole Company, many companies produce these citrix and other fruits. And so what happens is a lot of this agricultural runoff ends up in these beautiful beaches. And that may be a factor. I'm not saying it's the only factor, but we know that that highly organic matter in the oceans is no good. Yeah, in fact, let me expand on the loggerheads from Mexico. That's a very interesting story because as I was growing up, we'll swim in the Pacific Ocean and we'll see many loggerheads, juveniles, about 30 to 50 centimeters in length. I will say in inches, about 15 inches, 20 inches. And these young turtles will swim all over the place. Until recently, some of our collaborators like Jay Nichols and others discovered that these young turtles that feed in Mexico end up after 10 to 15, 20 years back in Japan, in sort of Japan where these species nest. So we have a species that grows up in Mexico, crosses the whole Pacific Ocean, nests in Japan, and after the first nesting season, the adults end up going down south to Southeast Asia or China. So it's very difficult to try to understand how a species, really the one we know with the longest migration across the oceans, can be managed when we're dealing with several countries, a whole Pacific Ocean, and yet indeed we can find out that these species are good sentinels of all these changes that are happening in the oceans.
Now we're taping this on Long Island, New York, and one of your concerns and something you connect to pollution has to do with these toxic blooms here on Long Island. There was something called brown tide, which in fact has wiped out the famous Peconic Bay scallop. I mean, it's coming back to a degree, but this was a center nationally for one of the finest scallops in the world. And because of brown tide, which first hit in 1985, a huge fishery, an incredible resource. Beyond all that, an important marine animal has become not extinct, but certainly limited in numbers. These tides, the connection with contamination, with the connection with pollution.
Yes, and many times has been related to pollution. It's very interesting that you mentioned that. We have different types of red tides, as we call them, brown tides, and we have also several species that have been affected and increasing in numbers across the planet. So it's not only Long Island, but we have seen, for example, domoic acid in the Californias killing thousands of sea lions, brown pelicans, and dolphins. we have brevetoxins. Brevetoxin is produced by a dinoflagellate in Florida and has killed hundreds of manatees. In fact, back in 1996, one-third of the manatee population was killed by this brevetoxicosis.
And as a robotoxa?
Brevetoxic.
Toxic, okay. And what is the source of that?
And the source is a dinoflagellate, a small, tiny algae that will produce this toxin when the environmental changes like temperature, like pollution, like agricultural runoff come together and cause these blooms. In fact, interestingly, the brown tide that you're mentioning bloomed back in Australia in the 90s. The population blame the factories that were across in Brisbane, when in fact the pollution caused by the local town into the bay was the cause of this proliferation, algal proliferation. Really, that's what it is. These are different species of algae that will find the right characteristics and will start blooming and then producing a toxin that may be lethal or fatal for many species. And for example, you know about the paralytic fish disease that we get from eating raw seafood. So those are all types of what we call red tides. And they have increased in the past 20 years globally in a huge magnitude. We documented more often in several beaches in several countries.
You also have done a lot of research on endocrine disruptors, which have had a disastrous impact on the marine environment.
Yes, it's endocrine disruptors basically are the same contaminants we've been talking about, like dioxin, like fire retardants, like PCBs, DDT even. DDT you can still find around, despite it has been banned since 1971. So these endocrine disruptors are the substances that in the very small amounts won't kill the host, but inhibits either reproduction or behavior. What happens is all of these substances are lipophilic. They're attracted by fat. And really, if you look at our body, fat is in the brain and it's fat in the hormones. So these substances in a very small amount, we're talking about one parts for billion, trillion, even quadrillion, are enough to change behavior or cause reproductive effects.
One part per quadrillion?
For quadrillion, yes. We're talking about extremely small amounts of substances affecting the reproductive system of species and also behavior. In fact, a recent study released in Philadelphia, this group of physicians and researchers decided to collect the blood of 20 newborns in Philadelphia. As soon as the baby was born, they collected a blood sample, aseptically as possible, sent it to the laboratory, and they found 287 different chemical substances in that blood that didn't belong to a child. From those, 150 are known carcinogens. So you can see how all these substances, or this soup of substances in the biosphere can deposit anywhere.
And what a soup this is, Alonso. I mean, you write, again, talking about the chemical soup, pesticides, pharmaceuticals, heavy metals, nanoparticles, ionizing radiation, industrial compounds. I mean, really, you really have to wonder about the sea turtles are endangered, no?
Yeah, that's one of the reasons. Actually, Carl, the main cause of the decline of sea turtles is fisheries interactions. We accidentally catch them as fishermen crews go out because of the methodology we've been using for years, hooks, longline fisheries, or nets. And so a lot of these turtles are bycaught, and I think that's one primary factor of the decline. So in some populations, yes, contaminants are a main factor. In some others, it's a compounding factors adding up to the stresses that that population is living anyway.
This very important linkage, I think, that you and your colleagues, particularly you, have made involves the connection between contamination, pollution, all these insults, all these onslaughts on the health of marine life to plant life, and let's talk about human life too. When you're talking about the emergence of new diseases, the reemergence of old diseases, you've written about Lyme disease, which sure affects a lot of people these days.
Yeah, Lyme disease is an interesting story. In fact, Lyme disease is known since the 50s in Europe, and until the late 80s was identified in Lyme, Connecticut. That's the first case, that's why it's called Lyme disease. And the species or the spirochete that causes the disease is called Borrelia burgdorferi. And Borrelia is an interesting organism that's transmitted through the white foot and mouth. And deer serves as a reservoir of the adult tick. So really the role of white-tailed deer is important, because now we have exploding populations of white-tailed deer due to deforestation. Deer loves succession in ecology. They reproduce, they expand, and not only that, humans remove all predators for deer. So you see, we start making the linkage. We have a human impact causing fragmentation, getting rid of the predators that can actually eat mice. We have exploding populations of mice, lots of deer that host the adult tick. And now we know that 90% of those mice, white-footed mice, are infected with the Borrelia, with the Lyme disease agent. And so, in fact, there are huge, magnificent reservoirs of the disease. Therefore, we are sitting in the hottest spot of Lyme disease in the world. It's the northeast of the U.S. Due to those factors, and by removing those species, we're learning that perhaps conserving these ecosystems and bringing predators back are going to help buffer the transmission of the disease. And that's what we called, and some of our collaborators like Richard Oxfeld has called this the dilution effect. That biodiversity and huge tracts of forests are important to buffer the transmission of disease. And that's what we're seeing with hantavirus, with West Nile virus, and other diseases. That by protecting the environment, we have a way to protect our own selves.
Can the developing world get to a point that it provides a comfortable society, so to speak, for its population, and not end up doing what the developed countries have done to the environment?
Carl, that's a very hard question in several ways. First of all, if you look at what we call the developed world, basically that's North America, without Mexico, that's Canada and the U.S., Western Europe, Australia, Japan, those countries alone, or those areas alone, what we call the developed world, consume 2/3 of the natural resources in the planet. And we also produce 1 to 2/3 of the garbage in the planet. On the other hand, 1/3 of the human population is sitting in India and China, and the other third within Africa and Latin America. So we have that huge difference in resources. We consume everything and trash everything. On the other hand, people live under $1,000 a year in many of these countries. So what we hope is that, for example, the new, what we call superpowers coming in, like China and India, that really are changing their ways, haven't learned what we have done to the planet yet. I think it's going to be a process of several years for them to understand that trying to live the American dream is not the way to go. We need to find smaller cars, electricity, nitrogen, many other ways of energies have to be used. And China is working really hard on that. Also, in trying to get the balance in resources. And I think that's where we're going now. I think the Americans finally are understanding that we don't need five cars in a household. We don't need this huge home to keep it warm in the winter and cold in the summer. So we're trying to get into smaller places and more sustainable in many ways.
I mean, you're hopeful.
Absolutely. Hope is the success of this world. You know, we have to be very hopeful that we have to change our ways. And we are changing, not as fast as I wish, but we are changing behavior in many ways. And we're touching a lot of people through the courses that we give. For example, I was in Brazil one day. And in Brazil, I was teaching this construction medicine course to all the high-level Brazilian people there. In fact, Brazil is at the vanguard of construction medicine these days. Anyway, in the audience, there was the husband of a veterinarian that happened to be an economist. This economist was the advisor of the Paraguayan president back then. That was back in 2002. And so he sat at my lecture, nothing to do with the lecture at all. He was just there, bored, waiting for his wife to finish the course. And he listened carefully, and then he approached me. He said, "Alonso, this is amazing. This is economics. We're talking about that economics is the way to see health and the world." And I asked that question, how many people have planted 100 trees in their lifetime? So very few went with their hand up. And he then approached me again. I said, "You know, Alonso, I never planted a tree in my life. Where am I going to start?" So lo and behold, he went back to Paraguay. And 2 months later, he said, "Alonso, I'm on my tree number 90. And not only that, we're involved the whole community and we're planting trees all over this neighborhood. And we're going to make it a national law. I'm going to propose to the president that everybody should plant 100 trees. So a little example like that in Brazil, where I was hoping to transmit my message to veterinarians, somebody that didn't have to do anything with the course comes and learns something about it and does something about it. That's why I'm so hopeful that people will respond in very unusual ways that you don't expect. And people tend to be very warm and very friendly about creatures and the environment.
I mean, the scenery is important, but what you're saying is that it's our health, it's life and death that the environment be balanced for marine life and for plant life and for human life. And this path that we're on is an unhealthy path. I think that's it's a very powerful and, in my judgment, quite accurate message. We've been hearing from Dr. Alonso Aguirre, a professor at a number of institutions, also an official at the Wildlife Trust. If somebody wants to get more information about your research at the Wildlife Trust, how could they do that, Alonso?
Oh, please go to our website. It's www.wildlifetrust.org.
Conservation Medicine on Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman. For a copy of this or any Enviro Close-Up, just go to our website, www.envirovideo.com. Thank you for watching.